mentions of various ISA documents and the fact that they've disappeared off the back of the table because they're not contained. They're all actually on the USB sticks that are in front of you. So all the ISA documents, publications, technical studies, they're all on there, and that includes ones that I'll use tomorrow. And again, if we can remind people when you make interventions, can you please say your name and stand up for the carriers, really be appreciated. Okay then, well, thank you very much. We've got two final talks of the day, and the first one will be Charles Baldwin talking about the potential environmental impact of seabed mining.
Thank you, Adam. I want to just thank the organizers of this workshop for letting me in. After listening to the really good presentations today, I hope I can not put too many of you to sleep. I was asked to talk mostly about process, about how environmental assessment is done, so I think it's kind of important to give you a little bit about where I come from and why it might have some value. I worked for 10 years for the Lockheed Ocean Mining Group back in the 70s and the 80s. I was in charge of the environmental assessment program. I worked with U.S. Lawmakers and lawyers to help establish the U.S. regime, representing, of course, the developer side. And since then, I've worked 25 years largely doing environmental impact work of many kinds. I've worked on programmatic EIS for mining of ferromanganese crusts. I've worked on an environmental assessment for carbon sequestration in the ocean. I've worked on things that really got built, such as power plants and petroleum pipelines, and things that we hope will be built soon, such as a gigantic telescope atop Mount Kea. So I certainly have experience in this area. And from that, you can assume, number one, I may be right or wrong, but I surely believe what I'm saying. So I'm either wrong or right, but I'm certain in either case. So the major things I'd like to talk about are, first of all, the general types of impacts to consider for seabed mining. And then I want to go through the specific examples of the types of seabed mining very quickly, to just get a little feel for what we're talking about in a general sense. And then I want to bore you with lessons learned in my life that I think are really critical for the development of the process of environmental assessment. The ground rules are, and this defeats the whole purpose of my talk, the impact assessment is inherently site-specific and activity-specific. You really can't do an environmental assessment unless you know specifically, very specifically, conceptual engineering drawings at least, what you're going to do. Otherwise, a quantitative assessment is not possible. And of course, you need to understand quite a bit about the environment that's going to be affected, or you're not going to be very effective at defining those impacts. It's also a key concept to understand in the process of the two approaches of environmental assessment. You can assess what the impacts the activity will have by looking at the activity and then looking at the things that it's impacted. Or you can look at the resources that could be affected by the activity and go the other way and look at how that activity might affect it. In fact, we do both things. Everybody who does an impact assessment ends up doing it both ways. The first thing you do is define the project. We spend, in my office, a lot of our effort and time fighting with the engineers, telling them we need more specificity on what they're planning to do. They want us to go out and do their environmental assessments and get their permits, and they don't want to tell us what they're going to do because that costs money. So it's really critical to understand these two ways of looking at it. So number one, you want to really clearly understand what you're doing. And number two, once you understand that, then you have a feel, a guidance for the areas in the environment where impacts will occur. And it's possible to do it from the other side, where you look at those resources go back and see, number one, what those impacts might be, number two, how they might be mitigated. Also, a very important concept for environmental assessment, and I think it's critical in this particular context, is the cradle-to-grave aspect of it. It's really important for a project to know everything the project is doing, from the planning of the project to the recovery of the minerals to the transportation to the metallurgical processing plant to the waste discharge. Now, an environmental assessment is very different from regulations in that it must deal with the project as a whole. Particularly in this context, the activities of a miner are going to transcend any one particular regulatory regime, particularly for activities in the area, because they're going to be picking up the ore in the area, they're going to be transporting it, subject to IMO and SOLAS and other things, and then they're going to take it to land somewhere and subject to some national jurisdiction. But it's critical to do an adequate environmental assessment, to do it from the beginning to the end, everything that is inherently part of the process. So given those ground rules, I'll do my best to go through seabed mining and see if we can get a little insight as to the important things and maybe set a few priorities for the things that this group can look at. This is generic seabed mining. You could draw it many different ways. We have to pick up the ore somehow. We have to lift it to the surface. We generally have to dewater, that is, get rid of the water we used in a slurry to take it up. And in some cases, many cases probably, there will be onboard processing of the ore to get rid of unwanted solids that are with it. Then we have to transport it to land, and then in general, except for very few products like aggregates, we have to do some processing to make it into something that's marketable. So those are the general things I'm going to talk about. And now I'm going to just list the big old matrix that we start with, and this won't even be totally exhaustive, but it should cover most of the impact topics that would be included in any particular activity. Number one, ore pickup. And this number one is probably number one throughout, and I'll be repeating myself over and over. There's going to be direct destruction and disruption of benthic habitats and organisms. Yes, there will be. As Nee pointed out, you got to do that. There will be indirect disruption through sediment redistribution and return of surface sediments and other kinds of things that can disrupt adjacent communities. There's noise, there's lights, there's mixing up of things that can introduce poor water that may or may not have negative effects. These are the things just ore pickup can do very locally. Ore lift is usually more benign, but you can quite easily introduce things into sediment, into the water column. Noise and possible disruptions of midwater species. You can create vibrations that might affect migrating whales or marine mammals and other things. The dewatering at the surface ship, that also has plenty of things to deal with. You've got suspended sediments. There's always a question of, do you dump the suspended sediments right off the fantail of the ship, or do you push them down back to where they came from? We've seen Nautilus make that decision. I don't think it's a general slam dunk that you always push the sediments back to the bottom again. In some environments, the environment might be better at accepting those sediments in surface waters, but that's certainly something that has to be considered. You've got temperature anomalies of the water that you're bringing up. It's going to be colder than surface waters. Usually it'll have more nutrients than surface waters and probably have lower oxygen levels. So these things all have to be dealt with. And you can avoid them by just returning everything to the seafloor, but that may or may not be the right answer. Then there's onboard processing, which of course is very specific to what you're doing there. And that could, in addition to the discharge of just the lift water, that includes processing chemicals and additional fine grain solids that could be generated by whatever onboard processing you're doing. And then every ship has accidental discharges, and the
the complexity of your onboard processing will multiply and increase the risks of these kinds of things, of fuel, oil, processing agents discharged into surface waters. You have air emissions, noise and light, and risks to health and safety of the crew. Transporting the material to land, you've got dewatering on as you go, which is something a lot of potential seabed miners contemplate, because quite often the ore will separate on route, and there'll be water that's sitting on top of it that you'd just as soon get rid of and not bring into the harbor. You face the normal things that your routes aren't the same as normal sea routes, so you have the potential of disrupting the routes of fish, marine mammals, and birds, because you may quite likely not be in normal sea lanes. You have all accidental discharges that normal shipping is prone to, and traffic impacts when you get close to sea lanes, berthing impacts in harbors, ballast discharges in harbors, accidental discharges in harbors, and there are others. I could make this list as long as I want to be. They start involving the land impacts, and they're very, very, very site-specific. Metallurgical processing is another one where you can make the list as long as you want. It's usually an intense energy consumptive process, and you've got generally wastewater to get rid of. You generally have air emissions. You have impacts to terrestrial and coastal ecosystem, impacts to utilities, land use, noise and lights, transportation, and definitely social impacts. So all those things are related to metallurgical processing. If you're lucky, you can just take your ore to an existing plant and not worry about it. All of us would like to have that as an option. Some of these ores won't have that as an option. The takeaway is from this list, seabed mining can impact some of the most sensitive ecosystems, and clearly the ecosystems that we really don't know very much about. That's the number one point. The impacts are to a wide variety of resources, biological, physical, and social. And they're potentially, and I'd say generally, under different regulatory regimes. So the impact analysis has to be very thorough, and it also has to be very focused. These things are often in opposition to each other, but if you don't do that with this kind of an operation, you're going to find yourself with 200 kilograms of reports and not a very clear idea of what the action, what mitigation to do, and really where you're going. So the focus is absolutely critical. And toward the end of the talk, I'll get into some ways that might help to enhance that focus. Now, I'd like to go just through the list of seabed minerals. I'm not confining myself, because my topic was specified as seabed mining, not deep seabed mining. And therefore, I'm including the other kinds of seabed mining that either occur now or have occurred or are likely to occur. So I'll go down this list one by one, and I'll try to make this pretty fast so that Robin will have plenty of time to talk before we all want to get out of here. First of all, you've seen a chart like this. There are dots all over the map. We know, and this is old. This chart, this one's about 3 years old. So we know that seabed minerals occur in many different environments worldwide. So we have it. There is no, to reiterate what I said up front, there is no impact of seabed mining. It's specific impacts of specific operations in specific places. Aggregates, they occur at high energy coastal areas where the sand and mud have been winnowed away. There are existing large operations, certainly in Japan and UK and other places, and they are growing as coastal areas expand and need aggregates for concrete and all kinds of construction uses. Generally, the deposits are less than 100 meters that are exploited. And this list, I'll just go from shallow to deep in a general way. Recovering them is very classic. Hopper dredge is one way. There are several different kinds of dredges. It's a fairly simple operation where you rake up the material, lift it. You can lift it either manually or hydraulically, and put it on the ship, and then generally you have to dewater and get rid of some of the stuff on top. The key impacts are right up front, destruction of hard substrate habitats. In the operations off the UK, this has always been the number one thing, and some of the environmental pioneers there are practicing seeding of hard substrate in areas where the aggregates have been removed to offset the really detrimental activities that removing this hard substrate gives.